And we thank you, Holy Spirit, for your presence. We thank you for these praise reports and the way in which you are working in our lives. We thank you for your word, Lord, that is living and active. And we pray today it will come through your word and convict us and teach us, inspire us. Come and do a new work of transformation in us, we pray. In Jesus' name, Amen. So as I was thinking about what to do today, I ended up with my absolute favorite chapters in the Bible, which you all know by now, 1 Kings 17 and 18. I don't know how many times I preached on, and I never thought I could preach another sermon on these chapters, but here I go again. So as I thought of what I wanted to share, this phrase came in my mind, speaking truth to power. And it's a very lefty liberal kind of phrase, and you all know what I think about lefty liberal things. But I just looked into it. Since the phrase came in my head, I looked into it and I discovered that the origin of the phrase was in fact with the Quakers. And the Quakers, of course, were called Quakers because they quaked under the power of the Holy Spirit at a time when nobody quaked and all these things were considered ungodly, even evil. And that origin of the phrase 1600s and 1700s was in a time of was actually connected to religious persecution, because they wanted to worship in the way they thought the Bible allowed them to worship, and the traditional church and the king, of course, who was connected to the church at that time, would imprison them and kill them. And so in a sense their truth was God's word, and the powers that be imprisoned them and killed them. Okay? And we've of course had, I guess, powerful examples like Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King, lots of movements that have exemplified in some way or the other this phrase. Today, in some ways today, the term is, I think, really misused, and often this speaking truth to power becomes, I just look around or look at popular culture and look at things like, what is this, what do people think this thing refers to? And often it can be, an ignorant schoolgirl wagging her finger at the UN, or sports teams bending the knee to a hateful ideology, or celebrities saying my truth as if truth is their personal plaything. But the point is this, that we can't speak truth if we don't know the truth. And really we can't speak truth completely if we do not know the one who said, I am the truth. We also need to know the powers that we are opposing, both earthly and spiritual. And so when I thought of this phrase, it struck me that the best examples of this phrase are found in the Bible. The prophets were always doing this. They were always speaking truth to power. For example, Moses talking to Pharaoh and saying, let my people go, that they may worship me. And prophet after prophet in the Bible is speaking the truth to people in power, and most of them paid the penalty, which was being killed in various ways. So my today's Bible hero, as you have probably guessed, is Elijah, the prophet. And when I just think of Elijah, I think of somebody who was raw and rough, socially awkward, politically incorrect, but bold and courageous and passionate for God's honor. And I wish I could be all those things, including politically incorrect and socially awkward. And he just wore whatever he felt like, some really rough stuff. I wish I could be all those things, raw and rough. I want to speak today of four ways in which we see him in this situation, in these chapters, speaking truth to power. And to learn from that, what we as a church should be doing. And please, when I say church, I mean I include myself. Just this Wednesday, in fact, I showed a video. Wednesday was it? No, Friday. I showed a small little video in our war room session. And there were 5 points that he said not to do or stop doing. And I had to say sorry for doing all those 5 things. You know, so we want to learn as the Spirit moves. And yes, we've progressed so much and we've done things, but there are also new things that we need to do and old things that we need to stop. So I'm speaking as much to myself as to all of us when I share these 4 things. And there are 4 C's. I don't know how God does this every time, but He gives me these things. Okay? The first thing is Elijah condemned the political authority. Okay, Elijah condemned the political authority. So 1 Kings 17 verse 1. Now Elijah the Tishbite from Tishbe in Gilead said to Ahab, "As the Lord the God of Israel lives, whom I serve, there will be neither dew nor rain in the next few years except at my word." Now of course there's a context to this prophetic word, context to this punishment that is coming upon the nation. And the context is in just the previous verses, chapter 16, verse 30 onward. It says about Ahab, son of Omri, who was the king, did more evil in the eyes of the Lord than any of those before him. He not only considered it trivial to commit the sins of Jeroboam, son of Nebat, and before that, Jeroboam's sins were the standard of sin. But he also married Jezebel, daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Sidonians, and began to serve Baal and worship him. He set up an altar for Baal in the temple of Baal that he built in Samaria. Ahab also made an Asherah pole and did more to provoke the Lord, the God of Israel, to anger than did all the kings of Israel before him. And we can be certain that when Elijah came and spoke about this, he must have mentioned why God was doing this, because we see him doing that later. 3 years later, this is what he says when he meets Ahab. This is 18, chapter 18, verse 16. So Obadiah went to meet Ahab and told him, and Ahab went to meet Elijah. When he saw Elijah, he said to him, "Is that you, you troubler of Israel?" And then Elijah replies to the king, "I have not made trouble for Israel, but you and your father's family have. You have abandoned the Lord's commands and have followed the Baals." So we look at this picture of speaking truth to power. We see this one poorly dressed, uncouth man before the king on his throne. And what he does, what Elijah does, is he proclaims God's judgment on a wicked king and his subjects, even his wife. And at first they must have thought he was mad. But after 3 years of drought, they were all mad at him. The king was hunting for him. The people must have been so upset at what Elijah had prophesied over the nation. Okay? But what we see here with Elijah is that he had no problem proclaiming God's judgment on evil. You know, we are so taken up with speaking of God's love and the gospel is good news. But Elijah had no problem proclaiming God's judgment on evil. And I think today we pussyfoot and tiptoe around the rampant evil around us, not wanting to offend anyone. Second, Elijah confronted the entire nation. There's that saying, you know, that one man and God is a majority. Well, you had the entire nation and you had Elijah. Okay? In 1 Kings 18 verse 21, Elijah went before the people and said, "How long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God," I'll use the word Yahweh, "if Yahweh is God, follow him, but if Baal is God, follow him." And so here you have one man standing against the entire nation. And what Elijah is doing is, he exposed the hypocrisy of their syncretism. Because what they were doing was, they were worshipping both. And everything had got mixed up. See? They now had a syncretic religion. They had compromised with idolatry, and Elijah is calling them to choose. Okay? And we see here really the echoes of the condemnation of lukewarmness in Revelation chapter 3, where Jesus says, be cold or be hot. And by the way, being cold, I discovered, doesn't mean be away from me. In that place, they had a cold drink that was really healing, and they had a hot drink that was, they had hot springs that were really healing in a sense. And that's what Jesus is saying. You can be cold or you can be hot. Both are a blessing in certain ways. Just don't be lukewarm. That didn't bless anybody. And in a sense, that's what, what's happening. He's saying that, that be all in if you want to be. Don't do this half-hearted thing. And again, I see here that Elijah had no problem proclaiming the utter uniqueness of Yahweh and the exclusive faith he demands. Let me repeat that, because these are words that are not used nowadays. The utter uniqueness of Yahweh and the exclusive faith that he demands. Today we are scared to proclaim Jesus as the one true living God for fear of being labeled intolerant. We are scared of being called exclusive, though there is no more inclusive faith than Jesus was, because he says, come to me, all. He says, I want none to perish, but all to be saved. But we are so scared of being called exclusive that we bought into the inclusive evil of the world. Third, Elijah challenged. So Elijah condemned the political authority that was evil. He confronted the nation and he challenged the false prophets. So he goes on after that. He says, I am the only one of the Lord's prophets left. This is verse 22. But Baal has 450 prophets. Get two bulls for us. Let them choose one for themselves and let them cut it into pieces and put it on the wood, but not set fire to it. I will prepare the other bull and put it on the wood, but not set fire to it. Then you call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord, Yahweh. The God who answers by fire, he is God. And of course, we know this famous competition that takes place between one prophet of the Lord and 850 prophets of the idols. There were 450 prophets of Baal, and there were 400 prophets of Asherah or Ashtaroth, and 850 of them. You see, the point is this. As I said, you've not just got to know the truth, you've got to know the powers. And Elijah knew that behind the political authority of the king, behind the social conformity of the nation, was the power of demons. And he challenged them in this contest. He knew that nothing would happen until he challenged the demonic powers that were behind all the evil that was happening. Okay? And he actually went further. He didn't just challenge. Then after that, we know he taunted them. He mocked them. He made fun of them. He insulted their idols. You can't get more politically incorrect than that, I suppose. And as you go on the story, the false prophets from morning to evening cry out. They do all their rituals. They cut themselves. They do everything possible to ask their deity to pour on fire, and nothing happens. And at one point we have Elijah laughing, mocking, saying, maybe our virgin is very correct in that matter. It says surely he is busy, but the word busy is maybe he's on the toilet. He just basically mocks and makes fun of the idol. You can see where I'm going with this. Elijah had no problem seeing the demonic reality behind idolatry and the wickedness that proceeds from non-biblical ideologies. Today we are too busy virtue signaling to see the evil in the world's virtues, in what the world calls good, what the world appreciates and approves, the ideologies and the virtues and the idols and therefore the demonic powers that are behind them. We forget about confronting them. I think the problem is we don't even see them. Possibly we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against the powers, authorities, spiritual forces of darkness in the heavenly realms. Elijah challenged those powers. He knew it was not just the king, he knew it was not just the nation, he knew it was the false prophets and who they were worshipping, or who they were emissaries and who they were serving. And the fourth C is Elijah had confidence in the Lord. See? We know what happened after that. Then finally they give up, they finish, and then it's his turn. And he prepares the altar. He gets it soaked 3 times with precious water, and then he calls on the Lord. In verse 36, at the time of sacrifice, the prophet Elijah stepped forward and prayed, "O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac and Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant and have done all these things at your command. Answer me, O Lord, answer me, so these people will know that you, O Lord, are God and that you are turning their hearts back again." Then the fire of the Lord fell and burnt up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones and the soil, and also licked up the water in the trench. When all the people saw this, they fell prostrate and cried, "Yahweh, He is God. Yahweh, He is God." We have one man coming before the king. We had one man before the entire nation. We had one man before 850 false prophets. And now we have one man looking up at the sky. Why do I say that? Because there was no tangible idol like the other guys had. Okay? I'm pretty certain that when they were doing their all that they were up to, they had an idol there to look at. They had the idol of Baal, or they had an Asherah pole which represented that goddess actually. Okay? By contrast, it's Elijah looking up at the sky, and at that point a completely cloudless sky, which reminded them of the drought of 3.5 years. He not only let the false prophets go first, it seems he made it as difficult as possible for God to work by soaking the sacrifice. And here we see Elijah trusting God. His confidence in God was such, because trusting God was literally a matter of life or death for Elijah. And you know, that is the case with so many missionary stories that we hear. For them it was a matter of life or death to go into these strange countries. If they didn't get killed by the people, they'd get killed by the mosquitoes or whatever germs or diseases were there. So many of them, and you know, people like was it Judson? Some Judson Hudson, I've forgotten his name. Taylor. Hudson Taylor. And we did Adoni Ram the other day. Even William Carey, they would come and be sick so often, lost their families, their wives, their children. They knew that coming and speaking about Jesus was a matter of life or death. I'm reminded of this missionary story. I can't remember the details and I couldn't find it anywhere, but he comes to speak to this tribe, and they catch him and they tie him to the tree and they say, "We're going to kill you." And then he's talking about this powerful God. They bring the sick person and say, "Well, let's see what your God can do." And it's a matter of life and death right there for him. So he just says a simple prayer. I remember he just a very simple prayer. "God, I can't do anything, but you please heal the guy if you want to, or I can die, that's also okay." And of course God healed him, and the village turned to Jesus and all of that. You know, our faith, is it a matter of life and death? You know, Elijah had no problem putting at the very least his reputation, but most likely his life, on the line, abandoned to God's mercy. God had to act or he would die. And I guess he was okay dying also. As all these missionaries were. He soaked the sacrifice. He made it as hard as possible for God, which meant that the glory would be all the more, of course. Okay? Today we have such a small God. We ask for so little. We make it so easy for our prayers to be answered. We give up so quickly when they are not. And we put our trust in ourselves and others much more than in God. I don't know how often we are actually abandoned to His mercy. Abandoned to Him doing something, otherwise we are lost. And of course we are called to be like Elijah. We are called to be a prophetic church. We are called to be a prophetic voice to the nation, you know. We are called to speak truth to power, but in order to do that, we've got to know God's heart. We've got to know God's truth. We've got to be able to hear God's voice. And then with confidence in God, we are called to challenge and confront and even condemn the evil around us, both the earthly manifestations and the demonic origins. And I fear that too often we do two other C's. We condone and we compromise, and we call it love. It is not loving to let people remain in evil, remain trapped in deception. And Holy Spirit, this is my prayer. Fill us with the spirit of Elijah. But the truth is, and we confess, that we are just too concerned about ourselves, our comfort, our safety, our reputations, what the world will think of us, what our family and friends will think of us. Truly, Lord, like your word says, we need to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. But even more than that, I think, Lord, we need this raw boldness and courage that Elijah had. Lord, I know it came from a passion for you, a passion for your name. Lord, I pray, give us that this morning. Fill us afresh. In Jesus' name.